Today, I'm back in my hometown of London, and we're going to look at some common English expressions that originated here in London. And you'll have a little bit of a tour guide, and you'll learn some interesting facts too. So let's go.
We're starting our tour here in Covent Garden. If you're visiting London for the first time, this will be one of the first areas you visit. It's right in the heart of the West End. It's a beautiful neighbourhood full of picturesque streets and squares, boutiques, cafes, restaurants and more. Covent Garden used to be the fruit and vegetable market of London. And if you've ever seen My Fair Lady or you know the play Pygmalion, it's where Eliza Doolittle was selling flowers when she met Professor Higgins. But when the market moved out in the 1970s, it was almost pulled down to make way for, among other things, roads and a car park. There was a campaign to save it, and thankfully they did. So we're fortunate to have Covent Garden. There are a couple of English expressions which originated here. The first is to steal somebody's thunder. If you steal somebody's thunder, it means that you are taking away the praise and attention of somebody else and putting it on yourself. For example, I made some cupcakes for the party. I thought everyone would be impressed, but then Sandra made a tiramisu and that stole my thunder. So obviously, people preferred the tiramisu to the cupcakes. I had a big announcement that the company had won a multi-million pound contract. I was going to tell everyone at the meeting, but Susie emailed everyone half an hour before and it stole my thunder because when I announced it at the meeting, they said, oh yeah, we already know that. That damn Susie. The origin of the phrase is interesting. It comes from John Dennis, a literary critic and playwright whose play Appius and Virginia was premiered at the Drury Lane Theatre in Covent Garden in 1704. During the play, there's a scene that takes place during a storm, and for this scene, John has invented a thunder machine so that he can have the real sound of thunder. He is very proud of his thunder machine. Unfortunately, though, his play is not a success and closes after just a few performances. However, soon afterwards, there is a production of Macbeth by William Shakespeare. John Dennis goes to watch Macbeth. Those of you who know Macbeth will be aware that in this play there is also a scene which takes place during a storm. And yes, you can hear thunder. And yes, they are using John Dennis's thunder machine. John Dennis is furious. After the play, he goes around town exclaiming, damn them, they will not let my play, but they steal my thunder. If you're in Covent Garden, the main square is called the Covent Garden Piazza. Not square, but piazza. It was built in the 1630s, a long time before the market was constructed in the 1830s. The architect, Inigo Jones, was influenced by European squares such as those in Italy, where they're called piazzas. They wanted one like that in London. The square has a church. What a lot of people don't notice is that it's actually the back of the church. Just around the corner is the entrance to the garden in front of the church. It is called St. Paul's Church, also designed by Inigo Jones in 1631. It's really a place of tranquility in this crowded area. So next time you're here, do check it out. My top tip, the garden is one of the few areas in London still lit by gaslight. Go there just before nightfall and have a look. This is Bow Street. The first professional police force in the world was set up here in 1749. They were called the Bow Street Runners. Almost a century later, the British Home Secretary, Robert Peel, reorganised the police and the policemen were named after him. Robert. The Roberts. No, the diminutive of Robert is Bobby. so they were called bobbies. These days, the British police are more likely to be called the fuzz, the rodders, coppers, the old bill, the filth. Don't ask me where those names come from, though. The connection with law and order has continued in Covent Garden to this day. Check out the Redemption Roastery on Drury Lane, a cafe which describes itself as the world's first prison-based coffee company. They train prisoners in roastery and barista skills, and when they are released, they help them find work either in their cafes or at their wholesale division. That leads us neatly on to the next idiom, and it's another idiom that originated in London, and it is in the clink, which means to be in prison. For example, he robbed the bank, but he was nicked by the old bill, and he spent the next 10 years in the clink. The clink was actually the name given to a number of real London prisons in Southwark on the south bank of the River Thames, which operated from 1144 until it closed in 1780. Now we are in the city of London at the Royal Exchange. It was outside here in the 1850s that the first coin-operated public toilets were installed. Yes, that's right, you had to put a penny in the lock to get access to the toilet. And that's where we get the expression, to spend a penny, which is just a euphemism meaning to go to the toilet. I'll be back in a moment. Where are you going? Oh, I just have to spend a penny. Definitely check out the Royal Exchange if you're here. It's a beautiful Victorian building. Get yourself coffee or a drink at one of the bars inside and admire the Victorian architecture. And next door, the Royal Exchange, is the Bank of England. And did you know it has a museum, which is all about, yes, you guessed it, money. And it's free. The museum, that is, not the money. It's a hidden gem of a museum, often overlooked by tourists and locals alike. Check that one out too. Now we're back in the West End, and this is Trafalgar Square, one of the most famous squares in London. It was built to celebrate the British victory over the French at the Battle of Trafalgar in 1805. There he is, at the top there, Admiral Nelson. Now, I'm cheating a little for the next expression. It's connected with Nelson rather than London itself, but it's a good one, and it is to turn a blind eye. Now, during the Battle of Copenhagen in 1802, Vice Admiral Nelson is in command of a number of ships, but he's second in command to Admiral Parker. From Parker's position, the battle is going badly, and he sounds out a signal to Nelson to retreat his ships from the battle. Nelson doesn't like this. He wants to carry on fighting. The order to retreat is brought to Nelson's attention. Now, Nelson only has one eye. The other he had lost in an earlier battle. So he puts his telescope up to his blind eye and says, "No, I really don't see the signal." Then he continues the attack and leads the British to a famous victory. And from this story, we get the common English expression to turn a blind eye to something. What it means today is to pretend not to notice something or to ignore something even if you know it's wrong. For example, he is rude, nasty, and often drunk, but the company turns a blind eye because he's the best damn salesman in the company. The president is destroying the country with his policies. Please don't turn a blind eye to what's happening. We're still in Trafalgar Square, looking at this nautical looking building. This is Ocean House, built in 1907, and it was originally the London headquarters of the White Star Line. And it was right here that you bought your tickets for the Titanic, if you were unlucky enough to get a ticket. Once again, a tenuous link to London, but as the Titanic is at the bottom of the ocean, this is the closest place to it, although not literally, of course. So Here are a couple of Titanic expressions. Number one, rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. This means when you're doing something insignificant that achieves nothing or very little when something really important is happening at the same time. So, for example, we have a climate crisis and the government's response is to replace plastic straws with paper ones. Isn't this just rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic? We really have to do something. Number two, and this is a quote rather than an expression, and it is, there were people on the Titanic who waved away the dessert trolley, which means enjoy the moment because you never know, it could be your last. On the northeast corner of Trafalgar Square, you'll see this church, St. Martin in the Fields. It's called St. Martin in the Fields because, you guessed it, when it was built in 1727, it was in the fields. Not anymore. If you're into unusual cafes, head down to its crypt. Get lunch or just have a coffee amongst the gravestones. It's kind of spooky.
What have you got there?
John, this is a sausage roll. Not any sausage roll.
Okay.
Because I'm a vegetarian. This is a vegan sausage roll.
Vegan sausage roll. Okay.
Only £1, by the way.
Is it?
Yeah. Well, so who says London is expensive? You can get a meal, you get a lunch for £1.
That's
£1.20.
Bad,
yeah. But there is a connection with a London idiom.
Really?
You know what it is?
I'm not really sure, no.
What if I do this?
Ooh, yeah, I know.
What?
Not a sausage.
Not a sausage.
Not a vegan sausage.
Yeah, exactly. So the idiom is not a sausage.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know where it comes from?
Is it something to do with Cockney?
It is, yes. So not a sausage means nothing, doesn't it? Not
yes.
a sausage. Yeah. So, for example, hey, John, have you got any cash? Can you lend me some money? £5, £10? How much you got?
Not a sausage.
Yes, it means nothing.
Yeah.
Or I could say, it doesn't have to be about money. Have you any information about the reality TV star here? She's got a new boyfriend now. I want to write about it in the newspaper. Do you have any information?
No, I'm not interested in that. Not a sausage.
Not a sausage. So it just means nothing. And yeah, it comes from Cockney, sausage and mash, cash.
Yeah.
So mash rhymes with cash.
Yeah. Okay.
That's how you do with Cockney. And then the word that you want is the rhyme.
Mm-hmm.
So sausage and mash means cash.
Mm-hmm.
So no sausage and mash means I don't have any cash, but now it's used for
more
everything.
Widely, yeah.
So
okay.
Very common expression. Not sausage. What are you doing this afternoon, John?
Not a sausage.
Really?
That's not true.
Okay. Anyway, I'm going to have my lunch now.
Okay, excellent.
Yeah.
Bon
goodbye.
Appetit.
Thank you.
Another expression to come from Cockney, to take the mickey, which means to mock or make fun of someone. For example, oh, I like your new haircut. Did you ever fight with a lawnmower? Oh, for God's sake, stop taking the mickey. And the expression comes from Mickey Bliss. Now, bliss rhymes with piss. And to take the piss means the same thing as take the mickey. Who's Mickey Bliss? Well, that seems to have been lost to history because we just don't know anymore. And if you're confused by this whole Cockney rhyming slang thing, then do check out this video up here that explains it all. The next expression, and I admit once again, I'm struggling to find a connection to London, but it's a great expression, and I'm having an English breakfast in London. A vegetarian one, of course, and I'm at the legendary Pellicci Café in Bethnal Green in East London, which not only does English breakfast, but also homemade Italian food, and it has been run by the same Italian family for more than a century. Anyway, my sort of London expression is the full Monty. If you're having an English breakfast and you want everything, not just a few items, then you should ask the waiter or waitress for the full Monty. This does not mean that you are asking them to take their clothes off, not at all. The full Monty means all the items, everything, all the items on the menu. And apparently it comes from Field Marshal Montgomery, who insisted on a full English breakfast and not just a part of it, even while he was on campaign. Is this origin story true? When you have to choose between history and legend, print the legend. That's what they say. Anyway, you can use the expression the full Monty in other situations too. When you want to say that you want all of something and not just the components. For example, you walk into a beauty salon and you say, I've got a hot date tonight. Do my hair, give me a manicure, a facial, do my lashes, wax my legs. I want the full Monty.
So a bonus for you, John.
Mm-hmm.
Not an expression, but a question. It's about London.
Okay.
And it's about the Beatles. Mm. Do you know the only area in London mentioned in a Beatles song?
You know, I have no idea.
Okay. Where are we now?
Oh, Bishopsgate.
Bishopsgate. Yes, wow, that's right. Okay. For the benefit of Mr. Kite.
Celebrated Mr. K performs his feat on Saturday at Bishopsgate.
Do you have a hot date tonight? Have you ever tried a vegan sausage roll? Have you ever been in the clink? Do you need to spend a penny? Where do you recommend for an English breakfast? Answer those questions and any others you can think of in the comment section below. Thank you for watching. Stay mellow and see you next time.